So at this point, what we're getting is a new column with edit. And again, we can set this up in different ways. Maybe we don't need to put a column. We could still make this edit button maybe appear at the end of the line of instructor. We can fix that in a bit. But before that, I want to add an actual button, not just the word edit. I want it to be a button of a pencil so that if you tap that, it lets you edit. So getting back to our code, our JavaScript, going back to line 131 or so, this is where we're building the edit button. I want it to behave like a button with jQuery Mobile, and that was working with data roll, button, data icon, pencil, etc. We can't exactly do that because of the nature of this, that it's being created dynamically via JavaScript. This edit button doesn't appear until someone presses the button, show classes. So therefore, doing the data roll and all of that doesn't quite work. The cool thing is that JavaScript can work in two ways. I mean, jQuery Mobile can work in two ways. It can apply to elements that exist at the moment of runtime. That's why, you know, data roll button works, because it applies it at the moment that that gets loaded. And jQuery Mobile can be applied programmatically, meaning at the moment necessary, at the moment we've created a new element. So we can apply it onto static content and onto dynamic content. The syntax is very different, however. And we'll see how that is right now. Let's go back to edit. We are still going to make this an A tag. It's still going to behave as a button with a tag. It's not going to go anywhere, so we will do href equals single quotes pound. Remember, the pound sign is the dummy link. It's going to behave like a button, but it won't actually go anywhere. But we need that then in order to add the following. Instead of doing data role equals and so forth, we have to do it this way, via a class. We have to add these things via classes instead of the classic data role, or what else do we have? Data transition, etc. We can actually do it in three ways. This is the second way, via classes. And so inside of class, we'll do UI-BTN. That will now activate it like a button. Instead of data role equals button, if we set something with a class of UI-BTN, it'll do the same thing as data role equals button. Space. We're adding another class here. You might say, well, that's really quick time saver. UI-button is much faster than data role equals button. Yes, but still, it's not going to be as compact as you think, because we have to specify every aspect of the button. Data role equals button does a lot for us. It rounds the corners. It puts the icon. It puts the drop shadow. Simply by saying UI button, that's like 1/8 of what data role button means. So we do have to specify the other things. We are going to specify UI-mini. I want a mini version of the button, not the big old button that takes up all the space. The mini version. Space. Yes. We want to tie together all of these in one single quote of a class. I think we could do class equals UI button and class equals UI mini, but that would be wasted typing. And we can run it all together in one single quote. Then we're going to have here UI-icon-edit. That would be the same as data-icon equals edit. And edit is the pencil, basically. So UI-icon-edit.
There's no comments or anything?
No. Just spaces, because technically what we're doing is we're adding multiple classes. More than one class to this one element. And the specification of CSS is there's no commas here. You add this class space, add another class space, add another one. This is the syntax. This will create the button. It'll make it smaller than the usual sized button. It'll add the edit pencil, but it's still going to display the edit text. I want only the icon. So we need another UI dash. This one is BTN dash icon dash no text. So now we've said no text. The edit text will go away and just leave an icon. And what this will do if we run it as is, we'll create a square button, because we also need to specify square button or round button. We want a round button. So another class here, another UI, dash corner, dash all. Because this way we can make a button that is only rounded on the top two corners and flat on the bottom two corners. But here we're saying give me a corner roundness on all four corners, which will create a circle. Oh, yes, good point. UI. UI, not UI. UI, not IU.
So make a button, make it mini, give me the edit icon, give me no text, and round all four corners.
That's the other way of doing data role equals button, data mini equals true, data icon equals edit, blah, blah, blah. That's the other way to do it, the second of three ways to add jQuery Mobile. The third way is via JavaScript. We haven't had a need to do that yet, but that's another third way. And of course, all of this we can look it up at jQueryMobile.com. So most of the time we're able to apply our jQuery elements the way we've always done it. But sometimes, like this case, we have to do it via CSS classes dynamically, so that's the syntax. UI-something. And I don't have any of these memorized, so I have to look it up.
UI button, blah, blah, blah.
And then the third way is just to jQuery. That's another way to do it. I'm going to save it and run it and see if this does what I want it to do. It should give me an icon, a small icon, with a button feature, and then for the user, they will see an edit button to make it obvious for them. Click that button. It's still kind of taking up more space than I'd like, but see, we've got the pencil.
And how did it know the pencil?
That's coming from UI-icon-edit. The pencil is edit. So if I put bullets, it'll give me my bullets icon. You know, dash home, and that'll give me my home icon. Pencil is edit.
I'm surprised with the spacing on it for the table. I'm surprised that it cut off your the arrow and adjust for that.
Yeah. It has to do with a variety of built-in CSS. The table itself has an automatic amount of space. Notice how there's this space between the C and the R here and here. So there's an automatic amount of space built into the table. We can nullify that by writing more CSS. And then this column here, it's all four columns seem to be taking the same amount of space. So via CSS we can play with that to stretch it out a little better. But I was going to say also, the problem is, what if I were loading this on an iPhone 6? No problem. So this is what we're getting at about, depending on the device we're running it on, we have different results. And that's always been a problem with web projects. Here it is on a Nexus. It looks okay. I'll see what it looks like on my real device.
So what are you in that gives you the option to check all this?
When I did Taco Run browser, it's loading in Google Chrome. And then when I opened the developer console, F12, in the developer console, then I activated this responsive view here.
Thanks.
And then up here I can check different responsive views, iPad. So if it's on the iPad, it's just fine. Plenty of space. And now there's too much space on that card. So that's our issue about how do we deal with all of these possible devices.
Probably use percentages in CSS.
Exactly. Use percentages as much as possible where appropriate. Here I'd have to think about writing some CSS to stretch this out properly via percentages to help accommodate that. Better thing to do would be, since eventually I'm gonna, if this is gonna go to an iPad, I'd want to write other CSS. I think the text is small, so I'd have to write more CSS to bump up the size of the text for the iPad. And we are able to do that. Quick sidebar here. On our project, on our Taco project, we haven't, we've been spending all our time in the WW folder. We have this merges folder. In the merges folder, we can write platform-specific CSS. We haven't done it, and we'll see if we get a chance to, but the concept is, if I add these different platforms, when I do Taco platform add iOS, Taco platform add Firefox, it'll create folders and merges, and in these folders, I can create specific code per platform. Thus, I can make this universal app that works good on all devices.
The best part about it is that every new month there's a new device.
The best, quote unquote.
You got a 7, 8, 10 inch tablet, a bike, different wear.
Yeah, and then for example, the Amazon tablets, they're like $99 and they're high quality Android devices. All right, so that there was just to show you we can also apply jQuery elements via classes when necessary, and it was necessary here because it's dynamic content.
It looks like the edit button itself gets bigger every other row too.
It gets bigger what?
Every other row.
Does it? It seems to alternate. Or is that an optical illusion? Because you've got a light color here and a dark color. It might be an optical illusion. Because if I put my mouse on it here, that's how big that is. If I put my mouse on it here, I think it's the same, maybe?
It's out of proportion. It's bold. It's bold. Your eyebrows bold.
Oh yeah, the text is also bold, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, so then.
Well, let's fix that.
Why is it bold?
Let's fix that. What's going on is that we defined in our CSS only the odd rows. We didn't say anything about the even. Therefore, some default is in the way. Let's go ahead and fix that. Let's write some design for the even rows. Let's go back to the CSS file. Line 53. Pound class table tr colon no spaces nth of type even. And then here we can set a background color and a color. If we do this, what if I want to use the existent color but just make a lighter version of it? We can do that. Background color. And the way we can do this is via transparency. We can brighten the color up. That's one way. Let me back up. Let's say I do RGB. I'm defining my colors. I'm just going to choose a random color. Let's see, not too much red. blue, let's say 200, a lot of blue, a little green, I don't know, 50. So I'm defining, I guess, a blue-ish color, RGB. No, actually a greenish color. Greenish color, 250, a blue-ish color. So I'm setting a base color for my odd rows. I'll say those are the dark versions of the color. What I can do then here is if I specify RGBA, that's alpha, that's transparency. So that means I can add a fourth value between 0 and 1. 0 is completely transparent. 1 is 100% fully opaque. So if I put here 0.5, I believe it goes from 0 to 1, if not, we'll see. It does? Okay. So RGBA, add alpha, transparency. So I'm taking that base dark color and I'm lightening it up. I don't know how it'll look, but that's an idea. And I guess put the color white just in case. Let's see what that looks like. So you see that RGBA, that's also CSS3. So that doesn't work on all browsers, so it won't work for us, it won't work in Internet Explorer 8. But of course this is never going to show up there. If it's going to be an app, it's going to show up on Android or iPhone, Windows Phone, etc. So here I'm doing odd colors, a certain color, I mean odd rows, a certain color, and even rows, a lighter version of the color. Perfect. So there's the dark color, and then there's the RGBA 0.5 version of the color. And then they're all of the same boldness and such, same size. Still not quite liking the width of that column. I'll have to play with some styling for that. But
just for fun, I'm going to add some other class with a long name to further test it.
And so here, I do want those to get cut off. I have a limited amount of space, so I do want those words to get cut off. I don't like instructor being cut off.
Can you go back to your code, please?
Yes.
And here in the, I'm in the browser.
And I can hit the, I can hit this rotate here, so it'll show it horizontally. Horizontally, plenty of space. Although remember we said on our app, in the config file, lock it vertical orientation.
Okay, we'll do one more thing and then we'll wrap up for the day.
Pouch, if we read the documentation, Pouch does not work on like Android 2.0, like old versions of Android. And so we should put in some code so that, let's say we let anyone download our project, Android 2.0 people, let's say.
our app would still be pretty functional without the My Classes feature. We want, you know, people with an old school Android device to still be able to look up classes and see the schedule and the map and such. But Pouch doesn't work on older devices. Someone gets their Android 2 device, they tap that, and nothing happens. Then they're going to give us 1 star. So what we should do instead is to do a little programming to check what version of Android does the person have. And if it's not within the parameters, don't even show the ability to use Pouch. So let's write a little JavaScript to do that. We can test that, because we have, via Cordova, the ability to check device properties, such as version of Android. Wrong version? Okay, disable some features. That happens all the time. It's a good practice. It's a good thing to do, because then you can reach more people, but then show certain people certain elements. I want this to happen as soon as possible, so
in the order of my code, I want to back up as far as possible to the very top.
Let's go to our JavaScript file, codica.js. And we're going to add this into the onDeviceReady function. Everything basically that we do with Cordova,
we should do it inside of an onDeviceReady. So let's give ourselves a brand new line 8 before the Cordova is ready.
We're going to write some code up here before the splash screen hides. I want to check, do we have the ability to do My Classes? If not, hide that button and then take the splash screen away. They'll never see that that button existed. So we're going to create a variable. We'll call it Android version. This is the version of Android equals device.version. This is PhoneGap. This is Cordova. This is Taco. This is APIs.
I'm checking on my device, the object device. Give me the version and save it into Android version.
We'll do comma because we also want to create another variable next line. This one I'm going to call Android ver int, the integer version of it. I want whole numbers here, because this might give me Android 4.2. You know, I want whole numbers so that then I can more easily include or exclude devices. And that's going to be set to the Android version from line 8, but converted to a whole number integer. We'll do this via some JavaScript parseInt. There's a method called parseInt. Parse this as an integer. Convert it into an integer. parseInt. Semicolon at the end.
I'm going to take whatever value that is, parse it as an integer. So in the parentheses,
what are we parsing as an integer? Android ver, comma, space 10. I believe that's the radix.
That's the base,
space 10. I believe that's what that is. Give it to me in you know, base 10 values, digits, whole numbers. Don't forget the semicolon at the end. We're done with that. We created two variables.
Next line, we'll do a simple if-else statement.
If the Android version is more than this, show the button. If it's not, don't show the button. We're not, you know, deleting the Pouch capabilities, we're just not showing it. We're just not making it accessible for people within a certain value. So press enter a couple times there, and then we will create an if-else statement. if something, do that, or else do something else. So what we're checking for here, Android ver int, so the integer version of the Android version, we're saying greater than equal 4.
So higher than 4, whole number 4, greater than equal. If we had simply put greater than 4, that would mean, okay, Android version 5 and 6 and 7.
We want Android 4 and 5 and 6 and 7. I suppose we could also do simply greater than 3, because 4 is greater than 3. But just to show you that way, we can do greater than or equal to 4. And what I want to do is I want to give myself a little console output, console.log. And I'll say Android version. Space plus space Android ver. In the console, show me what that device version is for testing purposes. So show me the Android ver. Not the rounded off version, just the whole number version. I could do the rounded version too also. The button is automatically available. It's on screen. It's available. So if really doesn't do anything else, the button is available. Keep showing it if you're over that limit. The else part, if your device is lower than this value, then we will hide the button. That reminds me, did we name that button? Okay, we'll need to name it in a moment. We haven't yet. So, the else part is where it's going to hide the button. If you don't have the ability to use pouch, then let's hide it. I'm going to copy the same console log there, just because I want to see it while testing it. But the trick...
What after right before the if? It's going to be called either way.
What's that?
Why not call the console log right before the if? Because it's going to be called either condition.
Oh, yeah, up here. That's true.
And you need to know the version anyway, regardless of which version it is. It's the same.
Yeah.
And then
okay.
You handle the condition inside the if.
Yeah. I'm just doing it this way because I know that it works. But as for testing it, that's a better point. Let's do that. Let's act like we don't know if it works. So okay, yeah, we can put it before there so we can test it, and then this will just, that's not necessary. This one actually is going to be empty. You know, do something here maybe. And so in the actual else
is where we will hide the button.
So that means we need to reference that button on screen. It doesn't have an ID yet, so this won't quite work, but btn my classes. We haven't named it yet, but the button on screen, we'll name it in a moment. We'll call it btn my classes. We're saying, okay, on screen there's going to be btn my classes dot hide. It's jQuery right there, dot hide. Yes, pound sign. Very good point, because it's going to be an ID. You guys are learning.
So. The ID, the element on screen, hide it, dot hide. That's a very cool, quick way to hide anything by a jQuery. We just need to reference it, dot hide, and it's hidden. Let's say we hid something, and we want to display it again later. What might it be called?
Well,
We have dot hide, and what would be the opposite? Dot show. Hide and show. I would have called it. I would have called it seek. Hide and seek. No, wait. It's hide and found. Hidden and found. Anyway, when they developed this, when the team behind jQuery developed this, they called it dot hide to hide an element, and if you want to show the element again, they called it dot show. Dot seek. So I think that's all we need for this. Oh no, actually we need to name that button. We need to name that button in question. So btn my classes, that means we need to go back to our HTML file, and where we've got that button, we need to give it an ID of btn my classes. Line 57, we've got the href data role, data icon, but no ID. Data transition, we'll do equals, I will do ID equals btn my classes. No pound sign in this case. So now we have that button on screen that can be referenced. We've got this if else statement. If we test this, it should show the button, because if you're testing it on the modern Chrome browser here, it's like the latest version. If you're testing it on your real device, it'll still probably show it, because it's a modern device. The way to force it to not work is to change that, is to change that condition. What about doing it backwards, or doing a higher number? What if I put greater than version 9? There's no such thing as Android 9 at the moment, so that should fail, and then it'll hide my button. I'm gonna check on mine if mine is working well. Yet, just a moment here. Oh yeah, there it is. So what does my console say? Oh, there it is. Android version 49.0.262.12. So that's clearly... What's that?
Too.
Yes, the Google browser definitely is the latest tech. I'm gonna try this on my real device just so that I can see that number. And then to try to make it fail, we would change that condition there, greater than a certain number, less than a certain number or something. We can even make it equals. Equals zero. There's no such thing as Android zero. That would be a way to make it fail too. So then it goes to else and it forces a hide on the button. So on my real device, Android version 5.1, and it's still showing my, so I'm doing my real device here, and it is showing the my classes. So again, to confirm that it does work, greater than or equal to version 4.4.4. Once I get that running, we'll wrap up. So here's our stuff today. We've integrated Pouch from last week into our project, massaged it up a little bit with some CSS, added this ability here. This is very powerful in this case here. What if you want to do other things that require a certain version of Android and such? Create this app that has all of these features, but then via checking version numbers, show this or hide that depending on devices. We do have the ability on a system level to exclude devices. They won't even be able to download the app from Google Play. We can do that. But then also, we can have it downloadable to most people and then just fix it up this way. So here now, let me load this up again. There we go. No button. That's my real device. There's no button there because it doesn't. It's not Android version 4.4.4. And so now my app doesn't have the pouch ability. The code is still there. It's still going to take up kilobytes and such. But it's just no. The functionality is not there for the user. Definitely. Definitely, we could easily.
That's the pro version.
In-app purchase.
Yeah. Greater than a certain value, and then have a new function, pay now.
Pay me now. And then have that pop up, and then. That's right. Definitely. So I'm going to put mine back to a sensible number. And that's it for our code so far. Any general questions?
Does the pouch work with pictures?
Pouch works with pictures, but the problem with that is that pictures take up a lot of space. You can save the picture data directly to Pouch, but a better thing to do would be to save the location of the picture from the memory card. So if you look up in Cordova documents, it'll tell us there, remember, we were able to take a picture and save the picture to the memory card. And when it's saved to the memory card, we can save the location to the picture on the memory card in Pouch. Camera. Installation, how to capture camera, one of these examples here somewhere. Success, options, camera, somewhere. Here we go. Example, get picture. So in here, basically, there will be an example of saving the picture to the memory of the device. And that value can be saved to Pouch, and then we can retrieve the picture from Pouch. Any other general questions? Yes.
If we wanted the page to automatically populate that table when we came into that page, before so the user doesn't have to push the show classes button.
I do have a little fragment of code for that. Let me save it into the network folder, and then you can put that in there. So there's a little bit of code that I have that if you want to automatically always show the table instead of pressing the button, let me put that code fragment in there, which is actually on my GitHub. So if we go over to Instructor Victor here, and then we go to part 3, and we go to Codica.js. Somewhere. Yeah, I'll put it in just a moment, but it's in here somewhere. All right, that's it for the moment. I'm going to save my code into the network folder, upload the videos and so forth, and we'll do it again next time.